So hello and welcome to Backyard Beekeeping Questions and Answers, episode number 80. And today is Friday, October the 16th. Outside, it's 46 degrees Fahrenheit, even though it is partly cloudy. And that's 7.77 degrees Celsius for those of you in the rest of the world. And this is the way to be. So today we're talking about beekeeping relevant to your own backyard. So this is small scale stuff, not necessarily basic beekeeping anymore. We are talking about a lot of different issues relevant to backyard beekeeping. And we're going to talk about issues pertinent to this time of year. So it's October. It's getting cold, too cold to be out in my observation hive building. And the questions that we're discussing today were submitted by viewers over the past week. And thank you for submitting your questions. If you want to know how to submit your own question, please go down in the comment section below this video and post a question. If it's relevant and has something to do with a broader audience of beekeepers, then it may be discussed next Friday. Also, if you'd like to go and post a question and not write it down in the comment section, you can follow a link that's also in the video description that takes you to my website. And there's a form there that you can fill out and you can say, don't mention my name, but this is my question. And what else are we going to talk about? Other than that, I guess we should just jump right into it here. The first question comes from Carol. Says, hi, Fred. Should I put on a solid bottom board for winter? Worried about the draft for screen and white mite tray. The bees can't get down there to seal anything. Thank you. Okay, so I'm located in the northeastern United States in a state that gets very cold, state of Pennsylvania. And I'm south of the Great Lake of Lake Erie. And I'm at 1,300 feet above sea level, so where I am, it gets really cold. Now, there are members of my beekeeping organization here that do have open screen bottom boards year-round. So it's not so much the bottom board, the bottom screen, or the bottom venting that is a big issue in winter. It's the top venting. It's the bleeding off of warm air through the top of the hive. So if everything's insulated up top, and down below it's open and there's screening, I do recommend that you put in core flute or something like that to limit the drafts of blowing there, because where I live we get high wind velocities, gusty winds, especially in the middle of winter. A huge storm comes in, blows the snow, and it just, in our minds, see, we think of bees and their comfort relevant to human comfort, and that's kind of a mistake because the bees are not the same. What matters for the bees is their ability to create a cluster inside the hive in the upper area there. So you've got your bottom board, here's the cluster. And this brings me to some other lines of thought about the arrangement of your frames inside the beehive. Some people like to take a 10 frame box. There are 8 and 10 frame Langstroth style boxes. So if we take a 10-frame box, some people have recommended to those who are keeping bees that you should pull one of those frames and then spread the remaining frames out. So the space that would be occupied by 10 frames gets spread out, and now we have 9 frames and a greater distance between the frames. And this is interesting because I have a cousin who lives up in Vermont, and they recently sent me pictures of their beehives. They started with their bees this year, and I noticed a lot of cross-combing and double-combing. And I think that that happened because they had too much space between their frames, and so the bees just started to build layers of comb. Sometimes it can cause them to bridge comb and everything else, but that's not the reason that that's a concern to me. My concern is that when we abandon bee space, they're called Langstroth boxes because Reverend Lorenzo Langstroth invented them and built the entire thing out of the idea of utilizing bee space so the bees could be confined to combs and frames that could later be pulled out and inspected or managed. So you could take out your honey, put the frames back in, and so on. So people think if we spread the frames farther apart, you'll get deeper cells, less wax work, more honey in the deeper cells, and that's potentially true. The potential drawback is extra comb, instead of drawing out deep cells, They may actually make another row and jam it in there, or they may bridge to the next frame and create a difficult situation for you for inspection and management. So let's go back to Dr. Langstroth's move, which is to keep the frames all together, shoulder to shoulder, and then to make maximum use of bee space. So when they draw out their normal cell depth, they have left 3/8 of an inch in between the two. Now they can wander and have unusual contours between the two, but you'll notice that that space is maintained. The reason that's important is because we're talking about winter preps as well. So if they only have 3/8 of an inch between your combs, even if they were perfect, so the frames, the comb, the face of the comb, now how do the bees insulate themselves in winter? The first thing that people assume is, just like your home, well, the house, the walls, the hive, the thickness of the hive, the insulation properties of the hive. To some degree, that's true, but to the bees, the real insulation is other bees. So they create an outer crust in that cluster for winter that is the oldest bees. So these bees are the foragers, the ones who are at the end of their lives and everything. They become sacrificial to the success of the superorganism, which is your colony of honeybees. So if they have narrower corridors to jam with bees, then those who are generating heat over whatever size brood is left, or even for fundamental survival, the temperature parameters are different. So if there's a lot of heat there, if it's 94 to 97 degrees, we know that they have brood active in the brood area of the hive. So they're going to heat that up right there, and then what's the insulation? The insulation will be composed of the bodies of the bees. Passive insulation. They don't have to generate body heat to keep that. They just have to jam in there. So if we have a bigger space, the requirement would be more physical bee bodies to fill that space to create that insulation. So I hope this is making sense. So if we have 3/8 of an inch, that's two bee bodies. Then many bees deep. Now we have insulation. Throughout winter, those bees are going to begin to die off, and their numbers are going to gradually diminish, and they're going to preserve the center of the cluster, and that cluster of bees is going to gradually move up through the hive. So we've learned that with that cluster intact and insulation above, we're going to talk about this later too because somebody else asked that question, but I want to stress on you that the reason I don't drop to 9 frames, or if it's an 8-frame box, the theory would be to drop to 7 and have deeper combs of honey for greater honey extraction. You're also assuming that the bees will then draw out those nice deep cells, which they otherwise would not, based on the studies about bee space. So my first recommendation is, when getting your bees ready for winter survival, is that those brood boxes and that super that you've got on for the honey to get them through winter. I really hope that if it's a 10-frame box, you've got 10 frames in it and they're jammed right together in the middle with the extra space on the outboard sides. So, food for thought there. So the other thing is the bottom boards. I personally, my favorite bottom boards, and I have two. Solid bottom boards, which is what this is. Solid wooden Langstroth bottom board, and it's reversible. So there's a deep side here, the side up. So some people call that the summer position. And then some people flip that. And then this is the side up that some people like to use for winter, because depending on where you get your bottom boards, this might be 3/8 of an inch. What's important about that? If you had a 3/8 of an inch opening, mice can't get in unless they chew their own hole. So solid bottom boards are my favorite. What's the position of this for winter time? You know, you can do the deep one. If you have this deep opening, then you're going to put an entrance reducer on, because we're also coming into height of robbing season. So we want a narrow entrance that they can defend. And you can also leave it in this position, because let's be honest, pulling apart your beehive at the end of the year, this time of year, and then reassembling it for some kind of winter configuration works against the bees. They have spent all summer long and all late summer sealing this up, shaping it, creating comb and infrastructure so that they can control their ventilation and appropriately heat their space to their own liking. And then so what do we do if we come in here this time of year and we rip off the tops. We change the box configurations. Now we have, hopefully while it's still warm, I did this in September. We pull off our supers and surplus honey resources, and then the boxes are there and the bees have the time to reseal everything with propolis. Propolis is the resin that they're going to get from trees, and it has to be warm inside the hive for them to work it. Just like it has to be warm inside the hive, 87 degrees or better, for them to work their bees' wax. So do as little reconfiguring of your hive as you can. So my recommendation also is plan for a summer and winter setup that may not change. So it's better for the bees, in my opinion. The second one that I really like, so solid bottom boards if you have standard laying straw hives. The next one is the flow hives, which we talk about all the time. Back here is a flow hive 2. So the first flow hive came out, it is a solid screen bottom board. And there's core flute that gets installed in there, and I'm here to tell you I don't like it. That's because I've been keeping bees in flow hives also since they came out in 2015, which meant we started with them in the summer of 2016. And the core flute gets jammed, there are grooves that get gummed up, and it is a difficult screen bottom board. So if you're looking at flow hives, two choices that I recommend. One is that you use a standard Langstroth hive, and all you get is a flow super to put on the top. So the flow super would be the top box right there, and that's the one that's got the flow frames in it. Put that over a medium honey super and a deep standard Langstroth brood box with a solid bottom board. But on this one, this is the Flow Hive 2 stand combination bottom board, which has a removable tray, an aluminum grid inside, and feet that you can adjust the height and leveling on. So that's my favorite configuration. I don't like the original Flow Hive bottom board. So that's a screen. So now, what's an advantage or disadvantage between a solid bottom board and a screen bottom board in winter time? We have increased airflow through the bottom with a screen bottom board. No matter how you slice it, core flute, anything else, the insulation properties are missing. Would honeybees, this is how I look at everything, honeybee biology. Would honeybees voluntarily move into a cavity that has an enclosed top? Yes, they would, a non-vented top. Would they move into a cavity that has an open bottom? 9 times out of 10, no, they wouldn't, unless they were desperate. So the bees are already telling us they like a closed-in bottom, a closed-in top, and a continuity through the walls, and the only ventilation that they would choose would be through a single entrance. When you watch videos of people ripping out structures, old structures, unoccupied structures, barns, houses, and so on, the very first thing to look at, and I'm kind of disappointed when I see some of these rip-outs, they don't spend enough time showing us how they've arranged their entrance only. So I want to see that. How big is that entrance? How large is a colony inside the wall that is ventilating singularly through that entrance? So what happens is huge colonies end up venting the entire hive, summer and winter, heated structures and unheated structures, successfully many years through a single entrance. So the bees are already telling us they don't care about an open bottom board. Well, somebody else will say, Fred, you know, what about integrated pest management? Because those screen bottom boards, if they're grooming off Varroa destructor mites and things like that, they're going to fall through and they're going to be caught in that catch tray. And that's something else I want to tell you about. So I'm not a fan of a complete open screen without an insert underneath that to at least limit some of the airflow through there. So if you're not doing a solid bottom board, you want a screen bottom board, make sure it's got adjustable slide ins, but expect those to start to get gummed up. The other thing is these require maintenance. The Flow Hive 2 bottom board insert tray also requires maintenance. You have to pull that out, you have to clean it, and in the winter time, which is what we're going into right now, if you've got the Flow Hive 2 with the bottom trays, pull them out, flip them over so the smooth top is there, and then close it up with that. Plus, there's a vent control over the back. It is, even though it has the aluminum screen in there, it is not an open bottom situation. They vent through the front. So, and you control venting through the back, Very minimal. So that's what I say about, should I put a solid bottom board on for winter? I say leave a solid bottom board on winter and summer, unless you have a configuration like that with removable trays and the ability to shut down ventilation through everything except the main entrance. So I hope that's helpful for Carol. Thank you for that question. Next one. How long do your flow hives last? In particular, the super. Some people say they only last a couple of years because the plastic eventually becomes brittle. And who sent this in? It just says, Be Healthy Plants is the name of the person that posted that. Be Healthy Plants. So here's the thing, and I said I would answer this on Friday, because guess what? I've been keeping flow hives and using the flow supers since they came out. First thing I want to do is show you the flow super, and this is what I mentioned before. If you want to take the least expensive route and you want to stick with all of your standard Langstroth equipment, and then just pick the hive that is the most productive when that nectar flow kicks in, and then just put a flow super by itself on that hive. So you can buy flow frames by themselves, and that's what this is. Food grade plastic, it's a flow frame, and this is a new one. So I'm going to show you this first. This is what they look like. It's in the closed position. The cells are intact. This one has not been worked by bees, and I want you to look at this end piece here and how clear that is, which is how we can look at it and see if the bees are finishing off the frames. And it comes and it's in perfect condition. And one of the first questions that came out was, how long is that going to last? Things are made out of plastic. So does it really wear out? What they do is they really get dirty. So I'm going to show you one that's been in service. This is the original 2015 FlowHive Flow Frame. And look at that. It's in the closed position. It is it didn't stop functioning, but what it did is it got so grungy, and I want you to look at those end panels. You start to not be able to see through them. See how dark they are? Now, does this mean that the bees had stopped using it? Would they no longer put their comb in there? This is the top of it, loads of propolis on there. There's a channel through here also that is difficult to clean. There's a channel through here. And you can see how all these pieces are together. I did a lot of things to try to clean flow frames. So it's one of the big topics right now. Because there are beekeepers like myself who got into the flow hives and bought them during their Indiegogo campaign. Thought, hey, great idea. I'm going to check it out and see how it's going. Did the plastic become brittle to the point where it no longer functions or it would break? No, it still has its elasticity. It did not become brittle. One of the things that could turn your plastic brittle is if you're going to put it out there in ultraviolet exposure, the sun. When you're putting out your flow supers and honey supers and things like that for the bees to clean up at the end of the year after you've extracted, always, always put a cover on them. I have extra hive covers. I put them out on the feeder station and I put covers on every super, whether it's a flow super or not. Even the conventional ones, acorn frames, things like that. I cover them anyway because I don't want it to rain on them. The bees all access them from underneath. That part's open and they clean them up for me. So how many years is that? You get 4 really good years out of them. If I come up with a method to clean them, I've even put them in ultrasonic cleaners, industrial size ultrasonic cleaners, and was not satisfied with the results because it's resistant to cleaning. The propolis sits in there and the wax is in there and everything else. So another option would be to steam clean it. So I did that. I ran it through a steam cleaner. And another thing that you can do to clean them up is soak them in bleach. So that's ongoing. If I come up with a perfect method for power cleaning, steaming, bleaching, ultrasonic cleansing, all these other methods, if I come up with something that will return that thing to its like new condition, I will make a video about it. But right now, I say you get 4 good years out of them. The 5th year, I would retire your flow frames. You can keep your flow hive and everything else because they do sell the frames separately. Here's the kicker. The most expensive part of your flow hive is those plastic frames. So I really think it would be great if the inventors, if the Andersons, came out with a really cool method for cleaning old flow frames. I know it's coming up. I know it's something to think about. The other thing is I got these chemistry lab style cleansers that are good for food service equipment and things like that. Now, suppose that works. So I clean the frames, and I take it through an ultrasonic cleaner and all this other stuff, and I find a solution that dissolves away the beeswax residue and the resin that's left, which is the propolis, and I get it all clean like new. What's the additional cost of having all that extra gear? I thought the power washer would be great, but you can crank up the power washer to such a degree that it actually cuts the plastic, so that's a fail. So something chemically that can remove the residue from those flow super frames, but yet not interact with or damage the plastic that it's composed of so that we can get it back to its like new condition. That may not even be possible. The wires that are across the top, the cords are stainless steel, so they're not degrading. So for now, I'm not throwing them away. I'm hanging on to all of them because I want those in the absolute worst condition, because I'm going to go from non-destructive testing and evaluation, which is my background, and I'm going to go into destructive testing. I'm going to see really what the material can take, what it can handle. And then we'll see how that goes. But that's it. But I would suggest get flow supers if you're in the northern United States or any cold climate. And you don't want to buy the entire flow hive setup. So you buy a flow super exclusively, and then you just put a shim on that, because a standard Langstroth hive cover will interact badly with that flow super design. It gets in the way of the removable parts and putting your key in and everything else. So you will have to put a feeder shim on top of that, which is okay because most of us have feeder shims anyway. But just get the flow super. Then you can put it on whatever hive looks the most productive. Because if you buy an entire flow hive and put bees in there, and they happen to be the ones that aren't very productive, that something happens to your queen, or they get overrun with Varroa, or something else happens to them, and they don't fill that flow super, and over here, two hives over, there's another one that's going gangbusters, and it just happened that you didn't put your flow super on that one, then it's better to have the flow super. Wait to see who's most productive, then put it on that one. That's all I have to say about that. Next, this is from Brian, Colorado Springs, Colorado. How do you manage the moisture in your hives during winter when you use the polystyrene insulated covers and have no venting at the top of your hive? In Colorado, we have huge temperature swings, and I worry about mold and freezing water dripping in the hive and hypothermia. Hypothermia is no joke. So here's what we're trying to do. Why would I not have venting in the top of my beehives? Well, let's go back. Let's go back to 2007 and 2008. I had upper entrances in my hives. I had tiny vents in the hives because I read a study that was going on up in Canada. And I figured, who's dealing with more cold than Canadians? Nobody. So that's what I did for the longest time. And then it started to make less and less sense to me, because even with top venting, bees would often end up dampened, and they would often end up frozen and dead at the end of the winter. So the question is, but then cause of death, you know, determining exactly what caused that colony to die. Did they die because water dripped on them inside the hive? Or did they die from something else and get so tiny during winter? Were they starving, for example? Did the cluster get too small? Were they unable to generate enough heat to keep that dew point under control up and around the cluster of bees? That's another possibility. Because then while they're dying out, what's going to happen? They can't generate enough heat. They can't circulate the air through the entrance. And then condensation would build around them, and they would become wet. If they die, they're going to become wet. So when you open up your hive in spring, this is another thing that people always frequently make the mistake of doing. Oh, those bees aren't very active. Something might be wrong with them. I need to open it up and look at them in the dead of winter. Please don't do that. Keep them closed up. But here's the thing. Often the moisture that you find on a cluster of dead bees is not necessarily the reason that they died. Because a really strong colony of bees is going to manage that moisture, and they're going to move it around fine. Now, if you've decided to vent the top, You have not necessarily killed, again, a large cluster of bees, but you've given them a challenge because the warm air that they're generating in that cluster, now keep in mind the entire hive itself is not controlled by the bees that are trying to warm the cluster, which is their life's blood, which is where they have brood, even in the dead of winter. The queen is laying some eggs, they're replacing some of themselves, and they're making new workers in there. So even in winter, this is going on. So the more you challenge them in the outer environment beyond the cluster, the more difficult it's going to be for them to do that work. So by venting through the top, they're losing some of that ambient warmer air that's outside of the cluster because you've also got an entrance in the bottom. In the wintertime, if you have a 2 or 3-story house, it's all buttoned up in wintertime, and let somebody open the front door and everybody gets mad, close that door because, you know, the wind might be gusting and coming in and cools the house off and the heater comes on and everything else. Crack a window on the first floor and see what the airflow is. Then go upstairs, 2nd story, 3rd story, whatever your highest story is, crack a window up there. Now go back downstairs and open that window and see how the air movement goes through that house and up out that upper window, and you just increased it. It's called the Venturi effect. So the hot air rises and flies out the window, cold air comes in and replenishes it. The bees occupy the hive just as they have for thousands of years. They're occupying a cavity. The bees are controlling that climate inside. If they want more cool air in, guess what? They'll send bees down to a lower level and they'll draw the air in themselves, and the bees that are up here in the heat with the moist air and everything else, and they'll fan it down and it'll be going out. So while the cold air is coming in and up and replenishing that with fresh air, the other air is moving out and going out through the entrance. So they don't need to have an upper entrance, which is what we decide they needed to have. And then the warm air goes out while cold air constantly comes in, and then we challenge the bees. Now, does that move moist air out? It sure does. The question is, does it have to? So if we find bees in cavities that they've chosen themselves, that they've modified themselves, and set up house in. Because keep in mind, when they move into the floorboards of a house or the wall of a house, an uninsulated old Victorian house that's unoccupied, there's bees that live for many years in an uninsulated wall, an outside wall of the house, and there's no upper entrance. In fact, any upper openings or softness of the wood or anything else, they propolize the whole thing, they seal it up, and then they have a single entrance at the bottom. And not only that, the bottom of that cavity is always super clean. So the bees have demonstrated that they control it extremely well. So what's our job? And this is how I arrived. This is, you know, I'm explaining maybe too much, but this is my logic behind it. Now, if all I have to do, we know that when warm air interacts with a cold surface, condensation happens. So I go out there with a glass of cold water and you put ice cubes in it or whatever. You sit outside, look at the outside of that glass sweating. That's because we have warm air hitting the outside of this glass, and it hits a dew point, condenses, and moisture collects on the outside of the glass. So we're trying to eliminate or reduce that hot air interface with a cold surface. So one of the ways that we can do that is by insulating the top of your hive. That's why I arrived at, and this is actually, it says how I always do. Now, this is a gradual exchange that I've done through the years. This is my 14th winter I'm going into keeping bees. I never do something across the board to all of the hives at once, because then I lose my ability to compare. Right now there's 19 colonies. So if I want to compare, I have to go into winter with some venting, some thinner covers. Maybe the flow hive covers are still on those gabled roofs. And then others, some of them, have insulated hive covers on them, because I want to see what the difference is. When I do thermal shots of them, where are they located? How are they doing? So this year, all of the hives have these polystyrene lids. They sit on top of the inner cover, but on most of my hives, they're sitting on top of the feeder shim, which we're also going to talk about in a minute. But this is 8 times more insulating than a standard wooden with a metal clad Langstroth telescoping cover. And the other thing is, I'm putting these on the 8 or the 10 frame. I'm only buying the 10 frame size of these. And I will put a link to this. I get these from Better Bee. Because I'll put a link to these and you can look them up yourself. These are really tough, by the way. You should paint them. Some of mine are out there unpainted right now. If they were down low enough, my chickens would eat those because my chickens are that smart. So you want to paint them to protect them from ultraviolet exposure. Polystyrene is a plastic, and it is what I've put on every single hive this year. So going into winter, now there is zero airflow up through the top. And that's what I'm doing. And the reason I arrived at that is because I realized that letting warm, moist air vent out of the top draws in cooler air from down below that is not under the control of the honeybees. If you did that earlier on in the year and you put screen tops, because I've done that too, I drilled holes in my feeder shims and I put stainless steel screen in there so that that would be a vent that would go up and around the feeder that's on that inner cover. And guess what the bees have done? They seal it all up, and they do that when they have the opportunity to do that. Honeybees on the go that are going through swarms, and once they bivouac and they send out their scouts, they're looking for a new place to live. They will move into a cavity that has little cracks and crevices and openings and possible venting going on through the top. But guess what? The bees inspect that and they'll move into it because they know they can seal it up with propolis. If these were huge holes, that'd be different. But little crevices, cracks, screening, things like that, they go right to work sealing it up and creating this envelope on the top that would be absolutely clear of venting. So, if we're paying attention to the bees and the biology of the bees and what they do on their own, I realize there's nothing natural about putting your bees in a wooden beehive out in a bee yard somewhere. But we can take as many notes from the bees' behavior and natural biology as we possibly can, and that includes no upper vents in winter, just because they don't want it. The other thing is also tip your hives forward because as condensation does occur, let's face it, bees generate a huge amount of moisture in the wintertime. They also consume some moisture in the wintertime, but the entire goal is to give them a space that they can have maximum control over when it comes to thermals. So that's it. And your job is to keep that opening clear on the bottom board because bees also, when you have the cavity and that entrance that they make on their own, or they find the entrance, generally they don't make an entrance, but they find the entrance and they tend to plug it up and close it down a little bit. There's always a big open space at the bottom. You'll also notice when you look at their comb and natural spaces, there's a big area directly under the comb, so it doesn't come in direct contact. The way a lot of beekeepers, you know, the comb comes right down, there's a space like this. Bees have a much larger space at the bottom, and that's where the dead bees and detritus and everything else accumulates, and then in spring when it really warms up and they can do their work, it has not blocked their entrance, and now they start to haul everything out and they'll clear it out on their own. So it's all interesting stuff. So I recommend don't do an all-in and all-out kind of thing. I would put that if you have two hives, put one with an insulated cover and one without, one with a standard cover, and maybe carry on with your top venting. See how they fare. All things being equal, if the bees go into winter together with the same resources, the same basic number of bees, and the same breed of bees, the line of bees that you're using, that can be very helpful in determining what's going to work the best where you live. That's my logic. By the way, there's no one way to do it. There are a lot of people that spend huge amounts of time figuring out how to vent the top of their beehives without causing a dramatic draft. But any venting material that you put up above your beehive, if you put pillows up there, or you put pine shavings, or you put moisture gathering material up there, part of that material is going to become wet because the air is moving through. We have the glass effect where you're going to have warm air rising through the hive, cold air from the outside interacting with it, creates a condensation point, a dew point, and now we're going to have certain percentages of that being wet. Some people that are members of my beekeeping association here have opened the tops of their hives that had configurations like that, and the entire thing was soaking wet. So, polystyrene insulated cover is just what I'm doing. But if you've got somebody that's got a successful method and it's working for them and the bees are coming out super healthy, then look to that, but I think it comes down to hive strength, food and resources, and an insulated cover at this point. This is Henry Bendick. Does it make sense to place a swarm trooper close to my apiary with the expectation of catching a swarm if they decide to swarm out from one of my hives? My apiary is a few miles away from home, so I'm not close enough to watch them daily. Thanks. Okay, on rare occasions, I've had empty hive equipment right in my apiary, and I've had a colony of bees, a swarm, move right into it. That is a rare gift that happens from time to time. So if you're putting out a swarm trooper, is really just a swarm collection box. It's just like they look kind of like a nucleus colony. They hold about 5 deep frames, and they're a little taller than that. And the ones that I have are sold by the Blythewood Bee Company. That's where I got mine, Blythewood, Blythewood Bee. So anyway, if you put those right, if you're putting up swarm traps, don't put them right adjacent to your apiary. The reason is, instinctively, again, we're going from bee biology. They want to spread out. They don't want to occupy a bunch of cavities immediately adjacent to one another. They like to spread out. They send out their scouts. They're looking for suitable areas well away from their current residence, which is your beehive. So your chances to catch them are the intermediate swarm landing. So when they've bivouacked somewhere, when they first fly out, and they're swarming out of a hive. And what is that? For those of you who are new, the old queen, when the hive strength is maximized, or there's some situation in the hive that they're trying to get rid of. But usually it's when they're so productive, they're maximizing their numbers, there's a lot of resources in there, and it's usually at the leading edge of a nectar flow, and the environment's going to give them lots of resources. That's when they reproduce. That's why this happens in the springtime. The old queen's going to leave, and she's going to take anywhere from 50 to 70% of the hive population with her. People always ask, well, how do they decide who goes and who stays? Well, any of them could go. So that's not easily decided. Most of the nurse bees stay behind because they're not flyers yet, and those that have only done interior jobs to that point also tend to remain. So now they fly out, and what they do before, they don't fly out and go directly to another cavity that they're going to move into. They bivouac somewhere. They collect on a tree branch. They collect on a fence post. They collect on your neighbor's mailbox. Hopefully your neighbor loves bees. But that's the time when I like to catch them. But Henry here is far away from his apiary and probably wouldn't catch the swarm when they come out and they're in that temporary location while they send their scouts out and while they're looking for a new place to live. So I recommend that Henry and others that are in the same situation get something like the swarm trooper. That thing, by the way, I've had them in trees for 2 years now, and they're showing no signs of degradation. So if you set them up right, they last a very long time. They're lightweight. You can go up, you can collect your swarm, and bring them down. So here's the thing. You want to put that well away from a couple hundred yards from your apiary. And you want to put them roughly at 12 feet off the ground. So the entrance of that is 12 feet off the ground. Somewhat sheltered. They like that when there's tree branches hanging over them and things like that, but a clear flyway to an open field, something like that. Southern or southeast exposure here in the northern hemisphere seems to be what the bees choose the most. So that's it, 12 feet up, a couple hundred yards away. And of course, if you have old comb, things like that, you can put that in there. If you have bits of propolis and beeswax, sprinkle that across the bottom and everything. There's also a lure called Swarm Commander, but you have to refresh that. You can also use lemongrass oil and things like that on Q-tips, in Ziploc baggies, and things like that to help attract them. So that's it. They will be more attracted to the physical space if they think it's been occupied by bees in the past. They don't like to move into pristine, brand new environments if they have other choices. That's what we're trying to do, trying to win them over. Like the Honeybee Democracy by Dr. Tom Seeley. Read about it, see what they do. So all that research has been done. It is not, you know, if I was buying a swarm trap, I would not put it right adjacent to my apiary, unless your chances are that you might catch bees from someone else's apiary a mile away or something. But for your own bees, if you're trying to collect your own stuff, a couple hundred yards away is pretty good. So if that answers that question. Next one, James from Georgetown, South Carolina. I'm looking to start beekeeping and would like your opinion on an idea. I would prefer to have as much like-kind equipment as possible. What are your thoughts on using only medium hive boxes for all equipment? As hive bodies, since 3 mediums equal 2 deeps and are flexible to add or remove as needed. Supers, nukes. Yes, I'm aware that will require some modifications and feeder boxes. Thank you for your thoughts. Okay, so here's the thing. A lot of people that have problems lifting heavier boxes do go to medium supers, and there's lots of commercial keepers that use medium boxes exclusively, nothing else. The advice that I give mostly on my YouTube channel and on these Friday discussions is relevant to backyard beekeepers, small scale. So I like the deep brood box to start, and in some cases, 2 deep brood boxes to start. So if it's an 8 frame, maybe 2 deeps. If it's a 10 frame, a single deep and a medium super, those become the resources that get used for winter. So these boxes are static, they get filled, and they stay on through winter. So everything above that would be mediums, unless they're flow supers, which are deeps. And it comes down to physically what you can lift. Now, here's one of the problems I think about when people use only medium supers. We look at, because one of the attributes that's described here is now we can swap the boxes around all we want and things like that, which sounds convenient, but we have to look at the normal size of the brood inside your beehive. So if we have even a deep, which is a little over 9 inches, a deep frame is often not deep enough to accommodate all the brood that the bees are going to put on it. So what they do is they start to build their brood. Here's the deep frame full of brood, and there's a little radius that goes up into the next box, into the next frame of brood. So the idea that now we can break these boxes apart, swap them around, now we split the brood and we caused the bees a challenging situation. So deeper frames are better for brood. That's why brood boxes generally are deep boxes. And double deeps get kept as brood boxes, and we let the bees configure those the way they want, and we disrupt them as little as possible. Once you do minimal inspections, find out what's going on in the frames, find out if your queen is laying, and so on, don't reconfigure those. In my opinion, these are just my practices, and my logic behind the answer is that you would frequently disrupt brood organization in the shallow supers, or the mediums, and if you can only, because the boxes are available, deeps, mediums, and shallows. So I use deeps and mediums. And so you consider your physical ability to lift the boxes. If you can manage deep boxes, I personally would suggest staying with deep brood boxes and then medium honey supers as you go up. And that's because, again, I realize that now you can't move things around the way you want to. That all medium frames, for example, would be very easy. That's all you would stock. So all I stock are deeps and mediums, and then, of course, flow frames, which don't match anything else. So those are my thoughts on that. It's not as easy as I think to continually reconfigure and have the options to have one piece of equipment, and you would end up splitting brood in spring because it would be up in the upper boxes by then, and if you had a deep box up there, or if you only had 2 boxes going through winter, then all you have to do is wait for them to migrate back down towards the entrance again, and then you pull that top box or reconfigure frame by frame. So often, I don't rotate my boxes, by the way a lot of people say to do, which would be to pull the medium off and replace it with the deep. So if you have 2 deeps, that wouldn't matter so much as long as they're all contained there and you're not messing up their brood arrangement. So I tend to leave my bottom boxes intact the way they are, and then pull frames and rearrange frames as their behavior permits me to do. When they stop using frames in their holes, I just pull them out and replace them. So I don't know if I gave a very good answer to that, but those are my thoughts on all medium boxes. It's good for us, it's not awesome for the bees. By the way, going into 2021, I'll be using one of those lay-ins hives, which, looking this thing over, looking at the depth of the frames, the continuous comb, because I also bought the foundation that comes with that. That's pure beeswax foundation. We're going to be able to see the bees' full extent of how they run their comb, how they run their brood, without the interruption of these horizontal bars as different boxes and different frames stack one on top of the other. Because we already know what the bees constantly try to do is to make this all one continuous vertical frame going up, because they connect the bottom of the frame above to the top back bar of the frame below. So they really are showing us again, they would like a continuous deeper frame. So the lens frame is really interesting to me. We're going to be looking at that next year, but I think it's cool from the ability to see the bee biology and see what their behavior is going to be and how they arrange. I would love to see perfect circles of brood and stuff like that, which we don't have because we're putting in boxes, you know, frames stacked and things like that. So medium supers all the way, convenient to the beekeeper, one type of stock, I get it, but I think you'll be disrupting brood a lot, and that's not good for the bees. Just an opinion. Next is from Nancy, Harleysville, Pennsylvania. Please review the different options for in-hive feeding, including pre-winter prep. So here's the thing. In-hive feeding, right now we have a robbing station, which is where they're cleaning up the frames that we've pulled off going into winter. In-hive feeding is the best for your bees, by the way, because you control and feed only the target hive. So as I mentioned before, a lot of my bees don't get fed. So in other words, if they've got a pile of resources and this year, they're chock-a-block, wall-to-wall with honey stores. So even though they're provisioned, they're ready for feed. None of them are going into winter with feed on the feeder shim. So first, let's talk about that. If you have an inner cover, most people do, unless you've got those migratory covers, which are just one cover, no inner cover. Backyard beekeepers tend to have more elaborate systems with more pieces and parts, and that's what's fun about backyard beekeeping. So this is an inner cover. Now, what we need to do is have a space above this. Normally, the inner cover would have the outer cover right on top of it with no space above it. But here in the northern climates, I like to have a space for that. So we go from the inner cover to a feeder shim. So that's what this is. All it is an inner cover with a shallow super married to it. So it's glued up. So it comes as one piece. This is on every single hive in the apiary. So now my options are there. Now, does that mean I leave that center hole open for venting so that they can have a top vent through winter? No, because when I put the polystyrene on there, unless I had a cutout, and look, this inner cover has no notching, no cutouts. It's a feeder opening. So let's pretend that we have that box around it. So what are your feed options? Going into winter in these cold areas, we know that we want to have the option to have liquid feed or dry. Going into winter, we want to give them dry. We don't want to add to the moisture there, and they may not be able to do cleansing flight, so we do dry feeding. So that is key in thinking about what kind of feeder you're going to put on this. So one of my fallback feeders, this is a rapid round. I want you to see the bottom of it. See how it's flush? Rapid round feeder sits over this hole. The early versions of this had a center tube that went through. So if you have that, it will go through this round hole. This just happens to be one of the flow-hive inner covers, but you can drill that hole yourself if you don't have a big enough hole for this kind of feeder. When you put this on here, you just close it up so there's no leak path through here. This cover prevents the bees from getting out into the surrounding area. These are practical because you can put liquid syrup in here, which a lot of people are feeding 2-to-1 right now, 2 parts sugar, 1 part water. Or you can pull out this center cone and just pour dry cane sugar in there. And then you leave this off and you put this over the top. Now the bees can't get out into the space. There's also no leak path for a bunch of air to flow out through here, that valuable heated air that they work so hard on. You can store this cover off in the corner just like that. Also, in the wintertime, when you get one of those weird warm days, you can pull the polystyrene cover up and you can look at these without exposing any of the bees below to cold air and without releasing a bunch of valuable warm air that they've built up over their brood frames. So you can pull that cover off and see if this is full or not. And when you do that, be prepared to add the feed right then. So that's one feeding option. Another feeding option is you have these Bee Smart Design tank feeders. So if you've gone to the 2-to-1, now there's another liquid that's out there that's made by Man Lake. It's called Pro Sweet. That stuff never ferments, it won't freeze, and it's good for all year round because it acts kind of like honey. So if you had that in this, notice how it has this little protrusion down through the center and it's got these little feeder holes. This would sit on here. It also sits flush and eliminates, again, any leak path up through there. I would not put sugar syrup up here in this going into winter, because they're not going to use it all up. The other thing is, I don't like having liquids on the hive, unless it's going to be, as I mentioned before, that Pro Suite. But this was an old design by Bee Smart Designs that used to sit on their ultimate hive cover, and it's been replaced. This is a better tank. It's more rigid. This has an option to have feed on it. I did a video about this exclusively, so if you want to just really quickly YouTube search for Bee Smart Designs 3-season feeder, that's what this is. The tank is heavier. It's reinforced with the ribs. This thing holds an entire gallon of syrup. And you can put that on here. And what this does is it sits down on the bottom there, but it has a very tiny leak path of air. There's a little bit of a standoff here. And this lets the bees come up and get their syrup from that too, if they need it when they rise to the top. And there would be a leak path up into here, but remember, this year, you would have a frame around that. That's also why I glued up the shallow super on top of this, because there's no leaking through here, no water entering through there. And then above this, we have the polystyrene cover with no venting around the edges. So this is dead air space up here. So that's another option. Holds a whole gallon. So if you're in spring, this is fantastic. Not so much going into winter, because again, you'd be putting Pro Sweet or something like that in there that would not freeze and would not be a problem in winter. So we got those out of the way, those feeders. The other thought that we have is, and again, if you've got your feeder shim up, this is a tiny jar, but some people like to use these with holes in them, and they invert it and they put it right over the hole in the middle. And I'll show you that again on the cover because I want to talk about it a little bit. Where I live, so this goes over the hole. Some people make inner covers just for glass ball jars, the tiny holes in it. These holes are 1/16 of an inch in diameter and they're drilled. They're not tapped with nails. Some people have concerns that if you just tap holes with nails, that when the bees stick their tongues up in there and they're drawing them back, they can actually cut themselves on those sharp edges that are made. But this would sit up there, but here's my problem with this when it's liquid feed. When the jars are full all the way up, not so much of a problem. In fact, if you're going to feed honey back to your bees, liquid honey, this is one method to do that. And you could do that in wintertime because it's the same thing that they have stored. My problem is once this gets half full or lower than that, we have this big air cell up here. And we've had mornings here in Pennsylvania where it starts out at 26 degrees Fahrenheit and by mid-afternoon it's at 62. What happens to this airspace up here when it gets hot and it starts to expand? It pushes the liquid out on the bees below and forces them to deal with it right away. So me personally, this is also why I don't put these on in the middle of winter too. Same thermodynamics, same bellows effect. And the more air space, the more thermodynamic there's going to be there. Now, if you have a big colony of bees, maybe they can keep up with that. Maybe they don't mind the honey dripping on them. But if I were putting these in here going into winter, I would use Pro Sweet or actual honey from the hive that it's going on. So those are options. What am I putting in mine going into winter just as an emergency pre-staging? I'm having rapid rounds on the hives all over the place, and then nothing's in them. It just blocked the hole. They're a placeholder. So then when I do thermals, as winter progresses, as it did last year, we had a mild winter, So what happened was all the bees started consuming all their resources really fast, and it scared me because I thought, I'm starving all my bees. I looked at the thermals, they're all up in the top box already, and some of them did not have feeder shims on them. So what I did was I did something called the mountain camp method, which I'm not a huge fan of, but mountain camp method, if you don't have a feeder shim and you've just got a little space above the frames there, you have to pull the inner cover. You put a sheet of newsprint down and you pour granulated sugar right on top of it. You poke little holes in it. The bees chew through the paper. They use the sugar. Guess what my bees were doing with the sugar? Hauling it right out the front and discarding it because they didn't want it. At miracle of miracles, my bees made it in spite of me. But those that had the rapid round feeders on, that got sugar in these rapid rounds, they were using the sugar. Not only that, condensation did form on the inner cover of this thing. And another thing I want you to notice about these are marked apis. I'll put a link down in the video description for this. These are lightly domed so that when the drips build up on the inner cover here, hopefully your hive is tipped forward. When the drips build up on the inner cover here, the drips run into each other and they run over to the side and then down the side, and then they actually contribute water to your dry sugar and they solidify the sugar, and then the bees still use it. So it's a win-win. It turned out to have a tiny desiccant effect, and it did collect some of the sugar, collected some of the water, solidified the sugar, and the bees, you could just see where they tunneled all through it while they consumed the sugar. So for me, wintertime, dry sugar. That's it. I don't put liquids in there. We do have ProSweet, but I'm going to use that for early spring buildup, things like that, for colonies that are weak, or for early swarms that come out. Bees swarm remarkably early, and it's not good at all. So anyway, those are my options. As far as the prep, nothing changes for my hive configurations other than making sure they're all tilted forward. Most of them are anyway, but a lot of my flow hives are tilted back because we harvest in that direction. So they're all tilted forward. That's part of winter preps, making sure the boxes that we're not going to use through winter are removed, making sure that there's no leak path. Coming up, probably next Friday, I'm going to do thermals on the hives, and I'm looking for those gaps between the boxes where the bees weren't able to get the propolis in there and where they may be leaking out. There may be air and heat leaking out. I'm going to seal that up, and we're going to do some tests and do thermal prints to see how that looks and how that works. So we're going to help the bees, because the reason those seals are broken in the first place is because we pull their boxes apart right at the end of the year. They've worked all summer to make an environment that they can survive winter in. That's all bees are doing. Two things. They want to reproduce. They want to configure their inner space so they can manage through winter. That's all they want to do. And then we come in and we scrape away all the fur comb and we reconfigure everything and we shape it up for ourselves. And then we throw it all back together right before winter when it's too cold for them to reseal the joints that we've broken. So there's a method to do that on the outside that we're going to test out. And if it works, I'm going to share it with you. So that's it for Nancy. Next one, Mark. Started my apiary this summer with a standard Langstroth hive. My bees seem to be heading into fall in good shape, and I'm already anticipating spring. I may have jumped the gun, but I've already built three more hives, a 32 frame horizontal hive, and two mini hives, in which each frame roughly equals a third of the deep Langstroth frame. Of these, you know, the population of these hives will differ. Do I have to worry that the bigger, stronger colonies will automatically try to rob the smaller colonies as a rule? Well, this comes into what we talked about at the very opening of today's video, which is we're getting into prime robbing season. I've had tiny colonies make it through winter, single box. I have that going up this winter too. Some are in a single deep and that's it. They have to have tiny entrance reducers on so they can defend that entrance. Bees that are viable, bees that have a queen, their queen right, the pheromones are strong, and they are sending out their guards on the landing boards and everything, they can defend even a tiny colony against a large super colony. And bees are bees, and when they get out there and they send out a huge foraging force, these large colonies, when they send out all their foragers and their scouts are finding areas to get into, they land on a landing board and it's got a tiny opening, and that scout lands there and gets chased off by a guard right away. They don't come back. They don't say, hey, well, there's only, you know, a small colony. They don't know what's inside that space. They're unfamiliar with it. They just know that at the entrance, the defensive measures at the entrance were strong. That's all they know. So they'll avoid it and they'll go elsewhere. On the flip side of that, if there's a big wide entrance and you have a small colony of bees in there and there's just a few guards, and while this guard is chasing off a bee over here, another scout lands and goes in through the side and gets up in there and discovers that they have a lot of honey resources. Then that scout gets away and comes back with 20 of its friends, and then 60 of its friends, and then 500, and then 1,000 of its friends. And then we have a big swarm going on, and they're overwhelmed. Where if we had had a small entrance, whether you close that entrance with screens, which I often do, or you have a wooden entrance reducer, if I had a small colony of bees, that would be about the size of their entrance right there going into winter. And then it's your job, of course, to make sure that this stays clear of dead bees all through the winter, but they can defend against a much larger force. Think of that movie, The 300. Of course, they were, you know, champion fighters and everything, Spartans. But honeybees send out their best, their most angsty guards. I have guards defending hives at night that I've noticed. In fact, at the end of this video, I'm going to put up a video of a skunk just walking by a beehive at night. And what happens? The bees send out into the darkness. They smell the skunk. He hasn't touched our landing board. In fact, the video cameras have shown for 2 weeks, not a single skunk has touched any landing board in my hive, in my apiary. But now they're sensitized to the smell of a skunk. So one just walking by in the middle of the night, you see a tiny entrance with screens on either side, and a few bees come out first, they go in, and next thing you know, there's 100 bees out there. And some of them are so mad, they fly out into the darkness and they go after the skunk. So tiny colonies can defend themselves very well if they're configured right and they're not given a lot of areas to guard. So reducing that area where the encroachers can get in gives them the ability to defend it. So there's that. They don't automatically, but we're in robbing season. If you've got wide open colonies, wide open hives, watch out, because it's on. Not only that, hornets and wasps are trying to get in too, and they're opportunists. So they're looking to hit things. Let's see what's next. Next is Wester Star Thunder is the name. First year beekeeper, my girls seem to be very hygienic. The oil trap has many mites at this time, and they seem to have sustained damage. So that means the mites are getting damaged. That's good. Their feet are probably getting chewed off, which is my favorite thing. I've often seen aggressive grooming of returning foragers by two workers at a time. That's true. Especially with the weaver bees. The foragers come in when they return to the hive. When they get up in there near the dance floor, there's also a cleaning station for some reason. So they get stopped there and they get worked over. It's just like a car wash for bees. And they aggressively groom and go over every detail of them. That's a trait of hygienic bees. Bee weavers have that trait. So our, let's see, but I know it's a risk, but I'm leaning towards no treatments this year. Our hive is a flow hive 2-7 frame that has a bottom spacer and a medium super between the brood box and the flow super with wax foundation. I also installed a beetle blocker at the entrance. Oh man, I don't have that. Anyway, also installed the beetle blocker, blah, blah. Thank you again for your willingness to share your knowledge. What do you think of the line of thought that treating for mites stops natural development of resistance, like Asian bees have done? Okay, well, treatment, this is the never-ending argument that goes on, even among beekeepers that have kept bees for a very long time. Some don't treat at all. And they just let bees die off that are going to die. Others do mite counts religiously, and they find out they have high mites, and they treat those. Here's my philosophy in a nutshell. I'm not a bee breeder. If I had 200 colonies of bees, and I were looking for that perfect line of bees, and I were going to sell bees, if I were going to sell packages, if I were going to sell queens, and I were going to work with a line of bees that I was proud of and would actually charge money for, I would do treatment-free beekeeping. because I'm breeding the bees. I'm breeding a line. Now, what happens to the bees in my apiary that would become overwhelmed with mites? Do I just let them go and see how the other bees hold up to that? Now, it's been proven not to work. So when you get a mite bomb in an apiary that's otherwise doing really well, you have to deal with it. So in other words, you know, Randy Oliver said it the best, in my opinion. If you're not going to treat your bees and they get a high mite load, kill those bees. Because if you're a breeder, now see, this does not apply to backyard beekeeping because we're small scale. So I'll give you my philosophy on that in a minute, but let's be bee breeders. If you're going treatment-free, Dr. Leo Sharishkin also believes in this method, treatment-free. So let them all go through the year, see who gets a mite load. When they get a heavy mite load and they're suffering and they're going to die out, kill them. Don't wait for them to die out because they're going to infect all the others, not just with the mites themselves, but all the pathogens that come with them. There's disease that comes with letting your bees that are under your care, these are managed livestock. You have to look at it that way. If you're going to let your livestock die from a parasite, if they can't handle it on their own, then once you realize they're loaded and not dealing with those parasites, kill them. Eliminate them from your stock. Then focus on those that are handling it, that when you do your mite counts, they are low. They continue to be low. There's nothing wrong with that. But that only works, the numbers only work, if you have 200 or more colonies of bees, and you're going to be able to, you know, here's the pyramid. Here's all the baseline of all the bees you start with. These didn't work, you know, and you keep working it up until you have a core group of bees and you have the traits that you want and you're breeding and you're selectively breeding for these traits and they're making it on their own. This is how the Weaver family got where they are. They let all of their bees die out that were not making it on their own. They bred from stock that survived. They got survivor stock. They bred for stock that attacked Varroa, that groomed it off, that were disease resistant. And so you end up with it that way. This is not something that a normal backyard beekeeper can do. So what do? If I have bees that have Varroa mites and they're not doing well, I'm going to treat them. It's livestock. I own them. I'm taking care of them. I don't want to just kill off every colony of bees in my backyard that isn't managing Varroa on their own, because would I be developing stronger strains of bees? No, I wouldn't. Because every spring they're going to swarm, and every spring they're going to fly off and mate with some local bee somewhere. So I'm not controlling the genetics. So how do I contribute to those who are doing what's being described here? I buy my queens from people that are generating stock that's of high quality. That's why when I fly in a queen, when I've lost a queen, and I can't do a split or something else to make a new one, I bring in the Weaver queens. Now the other thing is, if I were a purist and I really wanted my entire apiary to be nothing but Varroa resistant lines of bees, I would no longer split colonies. I would no longer allow my bees to open breed. The queen flies off, virgin queen, and up to 9 miles away goes to a drone congregation area and mixes with unknown stock, up to 20 different drones, and comes back with all those genetics. I've altered my backyard apiary, because although if this happens in spring, I'm getting bred with drones that were generated from colonies that actually survived through winter. So I consider that a good stock, right? But I'm not a breeder. So my philosophy on this is, because I only have 19 colonies, if one of those colonies is suffering with Varroa mites, I'd rather not just kill the colony when it is so easy for me to simply treat them with oxalic acid vaporization. And oxalic acid vaporization has proven extremely effective. So that's my take on it. Now, if you're going to be a breeder and start with a huge base of bees, and you are going to be able to exercise the genetics, and you are in an area where you can also have a breeding yard miles away, because you know, it's not just, all this stuff doesn't happen in one place when you're a bee breeder. You have to have all these outyards just for starter colonies, just for starter queens. And then you're going to have breeding areas where you also control the drones in another area. So when you have neighbors that are beekeepers, and beekeepers are doing it a mile away from you, 2 miles away from you, your ability to control your stock is basically out the window unless you get into artificial insemination, which is another thing I'm not a huge fan of. So the people that have geographic insulation from other apiaries are the ones in the best position to genetically select and breed their stock. That's why I buy my queens from those people. That's how I support them. So to go treatment-free, I think it's a great idea if the bees you have are not being affected and you're not just letting them die out on their own if they are affected and becoming overrun, because now you generated not just a mite breeding hive, but all the diseases that are associated with that. Deformed wing virus and everything else. Those bees spread that out because bees drift. The foragers land on different landing boards and go in. They don't have to physically have a mite on them. They've got other pathogens and diseases that they've got from the hive that they're living in. And maybe why they're so happy to leave it and go somewhere else. So you have to really, really give that some thought. There are commercial beekeepers that don't treat at all, and they just let them die if they're going to die, and they celebrate the ones that live. But what they don't realize is, I have to speculate that they don't realize this, that they're losing, there's collateral damage to that, that a lot of other colonies that otherwise would have made it are being taken out by the infestation of the mite bombs, the hives that are sick and diseased and not cutting it. That's my philosophy. So thank you for that question. And that was my last question for the day. So I want to talk about what's coming up. By the way, if you're watching all of these, this was number 80. So you might be losing track. So you could just click the like button down here and then you'll know that you watched this one. You may not have to look at it again. What else is coming up? Pest control. We have mice, hopefully not rats. But if you get mice and rodents and things like that that are getting into your bee equipment storage areas and stuff like that, I'm going to show you my homemade box method for collecting mice and rats and anything else that's coming in there. And we also are going to be testing the A24 resetting automatic CO2 charged rodent stoppers. So that's already in the way and underway, and that's going to be published. So subscribe if you're not a subscriber, and watch for this if you want to know how to keep rodents out of your buildings. Chicken coops too. I have one mouse, very clever, that is trying to foil my attempts to get it. So anyway, the other thing is, don't forget, if you're a flow-hive 2 beekeeper, pull those trays out, invert them, don't let that moisture build up in there, because when the moisture's in the tray, the bees are trying to dehydrate it, and they can't get to it. They can't clean up. So flip those trays for winter time. Otherwise, moisture could build up in there, leaks down in there, and then freezes and cracks out your tray. And check your joints of your hives for drafts. So look at the physical, if you can look at hive boxes and if you see light between them and stuff, think about sealing that up with something from the outside so that your bees don't have those drafts. Tilt your hives towards the landing boards. And for those of you who are thinking about buying flow supers or flow hives, look down in the video description. There's a $50 discount link for flow hive shoppers. So that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and I hope you're going to have a fantastic weekend. Oh, somebody asked about books. So starter books, beginner books, you know, there's Beekeeping for Dummies and stuff like that. I don't even own that book. But I think that there are some books that are worth looking at if you want to consider something like this, because I think that if you understand the biology of beekeeping, then you're going to understand why your bees are doing what they're doing. So that book, Jürgen Tautz. This book, of course, Dr. Thomas Seeley. A lot of what I do in my apiary comes from Dr. Seeley. This is a heavy-duty book. The Lives of Bees, the Untold Story of the Honeybee in the Wild. Once you understand what honeybees do on their own, you will better be able to adapt your own practices to as closely as possible provide the bees what they would have chosen on their own. And of course, the other one that we have to talk about, Keeping Bees with a Smile, the Principles and Practice of Natural Beekeeping. Of course, we're doing the horizontal long Langstroth hive this year, horizontalhives.com. And we have the Lands hive, inspired, of course, by this book. So now, Dr. Leo, he's one of the people that would agree with letting bees die if they die. and letting bees live and working with those that live that handle everything on their own, and only, of course, working with local stock, bees that you find already in your environment, adapted to the area, climate, and the forage resources that you have. So in Dr. Leo's words, you're starting very well if you pick bees that are already adapted to where you reside instead of bringing them in from some faraway place. So once again, thanks for watching. Hope you found today's video helpful. Thank you.